But for many of the world's children, tomorrow is a privilege that will never come. By this time tomorrow, 40,000 small children below the age of 5, the equivalent of 1,000 nursery classes like this, will be dead. It's a disaster which, of course, will scarcely touch us in the West. It will take place in Africa and the Middle East, in Asia and Latin America, in the so-called developing world, an expression which is itself mocked by those figures. And it will happen tomorrow, as it did today, at the rate of one young death every 2 seconds. On average, 3 children died in the time it took me to speak that last sentence, their death sentence. And this is the central tragedy, indeed the central scandal, in the United Nations Children's Fund report on the state of the world's children.
We have been particularly interested in ways by which the mother herself can make up the solution. Most houses in our homes in our world, however poor, have salt and sugar. And we teach the mother very simply to make up a level spoon of this salt. She makes the oral rehydration fluid with that amount of salt, and the other end, the bigger end of sugar, into a glass of water.
The spoons are now being made in the Third World and in Britain. This factory, Plastic Moulders Limited at Wetherby in Yorkshire, turned out 120,000 of them last year. The factory was one of the first in the world to produce the spoons. They're now working overtime to meet a new order from a British charitable organisation called Talc, which distributes low-cost health materials in the Third World. Making the original mould cost around £2,000, but the spoons themselves, with instructions on the back, are being turned out at 2.5 pence a time.
The mould is quite expensive, but taking into account the many millions of items it will produce, at the end of the day, the cost is insignificant.
Peter Adamson, with the assistance of his wife Leslie, has written the United Nations Children's Fund report and is now preparing a longer version in book form.
Okay. Right, well, in Central America, we've got Nicaragua and Honduras.
Much of the evidence they've gathered from around the world concerns the progress of the sugar, salt and water treatment.
Yes, that's a good one.
Oral rehydration, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, there have been some fantastic results. In the places where it's been done well, it has succeeded in halving child deaths from diarrheal infections. That's happened in areas of 10 villages here, a whole area of villages there. Deaths have been halved in places as far apart as Nepal, in Guatemala, in the whole region of Guatemala, child deaths halved, in villages in Bangladesh, in India, in Egypt. Some great success has been chalked up in very, very quick time, a year or two.
What kind of system is needed to make it effective? What kind of structure does there have to be?
The structure is the real problem now. The technology is there. What's missing is a delivery system to get this idea and the means to save all these lives out to people where it's needed. Only about a quarter, at most a quarter, of the children in the poor world are within reach of the conventional health services, the doctors and the clinics. For the other three quarters, the ones in most need, it's going to have to depend upon something going way beyond the health services. It's going to have to depend on everybody, water engineers, civil servants, mothers' meetings, schools, syllabuses, teachers, priests, imams, churches, the Red Cross, the family planning movements, the business communities, the small local shops. I mean, mass involvement by the community. That's what's needed to get this idea off the shelf of its potential and out into people's lives where it can save lives and promote health.
There are myths about third world health, in particular myths about malnutrition. A child who doesn't show the obvious symptoms of starvation may yet be headed towards disaster, with low energy and low resistance to disease. The UN report argues the case for a cheap, straightforward strategy to combat invisible danger.
We've overcome this by using very simple growth charts on which we can plot the weight of the child month by month. Now, children in the first 5 years of life should be gaining weight quite steadily. Unfortunately, very often, particularly when they stop breastfeeding, they have a period of 6-9 months when they hardly gain a weight, may even lose weight. And it is this that we want to point out to the mother so that she, with help from health workers, can give the child appropriate food so that the child grows better.
The cost of this plan, the cost of halving child deaths in the world, to put a figure on it, is about $12 billion a year. Well, it sounds like an enormous sum, and it is an enormous sum, but it's about what the world spends on armaments every week. Well, that kind of comparison, I suppose, is a cliche of world poverty, and in practice, there's not going to be a big increase in resources because of the recession. In fact, for the next 10 years, there's not going to be a very significant increase in the amount of money available for improving children's health in the world.
Sometimes big business doesn't help either. The trend towards bottle feeding of third world babies, backed by heavy promotion, is the third concern of the UN report. The risks can be seen on this coffee farm in Kenya. A working mother feeds her baby. Neither her hands nor the bottle can possibly be clean. The World Health Organization has tried, with limited success, to restrict advertising of powdered milk products in the third world, where poor standards of hygiene and polluted water make them hazardous to children's health.
I've seen infants that have stopped breastfeeding at a very early stage, maybe 1 month, maybe 2 months of age, maybe breastfed for only a week or so, and then have gone back and have been put on a formula or cow's milk or some other form of feeding or even water or whatever, and these have been contaminated and the child died out of diarrhea and vomiting or outright malnutrition from failure to breastfeed.
And as health workers are finding each day, the trend towards bottle feeding goes on.
Why does this lady bottle feed her baby?
Because she said she had not enough milk to make the baby being satisfied.
Now, what do you tell her about bottle feeding?
I have told her that the bottle feeding is not so good when the baby is getting bottle feed, and when it is not clean, the baby will be getting so many diseases like diarrheal diseases.
Is this a kind of problem that you come across often in this area?
It is so common, so common.
The campaign to change from bottle to breast is far from being won.
In the West, the severity declined earlier because the standard of living and the nutrition improved. But we cannot wait for that in the third world. We must be trying to improve the nutrition and living conditions. But by the immunizations, we can bring this in very much earlier, if only we can get the children immunized at the right age.
On many counts, the UN report on the state of the world's children is a challenge to governments in the third world and in the West. And one of the sharpest challenges is the statistical sting in the tail of the report. A list of the countries of the world, not in order of wealth or GNP, but the health of their children, measured by infant mortality, the number of babies who die before the age of one. At first glance, things are much as you might expect. The lowest figures for infant mortality, 7 out of every 1,000 births, occur in Finland, Japan, and Sweden. All of them near the top of the league table of wealth. The highest death figure, 200 and 200 plus, occur in Afghanistan, Sierra Leone, and Upper Volta, all of them around the bottom in terms of wealth. And in general, the figures predictably support the point that more babies die in poor countries than in rich countries. But what is surprising and encouraging are the stories of success. All of these 11 countries, when measured by infant survival rates, are between 30 and 60 places higher than when measured in terms of wealth. And these are countries with widely different political systems, which clearly must have something else in common other than ideology.
Commitment. the commitment of a nation's leadership to doing it. It's been done on a massive scale, say, in, to take two left-wing countries, in China and in Cuba, and very successfully. And no one, whatever their ideology, can take that achievement away from them. But neither can it be said that the left-wing governments have a monopoly on that kind of success, because other governments of other political persuasions, the Sri Lankas, the Indian state of Kerala, very prominent example, South Korea, Taiwan, to take more right-wing states, have also achieved tremendous things in reducing child deaths very drastically over the last 10, 20 years.
If the UN achieves its target of cutting 15 million child deaths a year by half, might that not lead to further overpopulation and deprivation in countries that are already overcrowded?
Paradoxically, the answer is no, it wouldn't. Because there's never been a steep fall in birth rates anywhere in the world which hasn't been preceded by a steep fall in the child death rate. And the main reason is that if parents in the poor world can be sure that their children will survive, they have less children. In many parts of the world, you have to have six children to be about 90% sure of having one surviving son, which most parents reasonably want. But if children survive, they have more confidence and they have fewer children. So the net result of a children's health revolution and the saving of millions of children's lives would be a slowing down of population growth.
Not just sweetness, but life itself. That's the gift that three simple substances can offer. Why has it taken so long for the secret to be revealed? James Grant is executive director of the United Nations Children's Fund.
Well, it's primarily because oral rehydration therapy relates to disease of the very poor. And it has been hard to get the communications agencies of the world to bring it to the attention of the poor. If this were obviously a cure for cancer, of the affluent, 5 million people dying of cancer deaths a year for which there was a cure, you could expect that literally within 90 days, 90% of them would know.
Have there been examples from which perhaps lessons have been learned of how it didn't work, how the campaign hasn't worked?
What we are learning is that where, for example, you want to convince 100 illiterate mothers to use oral rehydration therapy in their home, that it is insufficient to just approach that mother once. You teach her how to use it, you come back 6 months later, you find that she knows exactly how to use oral rehydration therapy, but you'll discover in 9 cases out of 10, she won't have used it. And what we have learned is that if on some important matter you want to get the mother to do something differently, she has to hear about it from a number of different sources that corroborate. So if you can get the local parish priest, have the school teacher or the 9-year-old daughter come home and say, I learned in school yesterday that oral rehydration therapy works. Then if the mother's been approached and learned how to do it, then we find the actual utilization rate goes up to 50, 60, 70%.
A British baby plays with what is for him a toy. But the toy is made of measuring spoons for sugar and salt, in different colors, with instructions in different languages. If the meaning of the spoons can be spread throughout the Third World, they will help to save the lives of millions of babies like him. They're already part of what the United Nations Children's Fund means by the children's revolution.
We mean the saving of 20,000 children's lives every day. But it's not just the saving of lives. Life and death is easy to measure. A child is dead or not dead. And that's why this children's revolution is best measured by how many lives it can save. But every life saved represents many, many more lives healthier. For every child who dies of this combination of malnutrition and infection, these simple things, these simple repeated illnesses, there are 6, 7 more children who live on in hunger and ill health with poor mental and physical development. So even if this children's revolution saved no lives, it would still be vitally important for promoting the normal physical and mental development and health of many millions more children throughout the world. And that has to have a big impact on the social and economic development of nations. So in every way, this is fundamental.